I've been at this for a long, long time. And if I thanked everyone that has helped me, I would never come to the end of the list. There's been so many thousands and thousands of people in all different types of research. There's so much information has come to light now over the last 20 years or so. It's been absolutely amazing. There's so many specialists out there digging up information, helping awareness grow. And my job has always been to put all the dots together. I'm a generalist, to connect all the dots. That wouldn't be possible if there weren't all these specialists out there. The problem is, when the big picture is presented, the specialists are so used to focusing just on a small part of the puzzle that they really are unable to see or appreciate the big picture. So it's kind of a conundrum there. You put it all together and yet it doesn't really resonate that far. Maybe other generalists, it resonates with them. The problem is right now that the synchronicities that are taking place are almost beyond belief, really. It stretches our belief beyond what we're used to. I mean, how can we fathom what is taking place right now? Well, on the 10th anniversary of 9/11, we have this comet, which could be a supercapacitor. And it's perihelion, close to the sun. And as comet Elenin continues its trajectory and swing through the solar system, there are key points where it is possible that its electrical charge could trigger a massive coronal mass ejection explosion from the sun, and it could be a class 5 flare. And it's possible that class 5 flare could head straight to this planet at the very same time as it hits the planet, impacts the planet. It could very well severely damage our capabilities to move data as satellites are impacted. With the inability to move data, you have a complete logjam meltdown of the world financial trading commodity distribution structure. And at the very same time, you have those who have infiltrated this structure, planetary activists who believe that humanity is killing the planet by wiping out its ecosystems and its resources, who have worked to find a way to crash the whole system. They will use this opportune moment to employ their kind of what you call a doomsday algorithmic program that they have set up to basically snarl the entire system from their end of things. So the combination of the class 5 flare and the algorithmic terrorism, so to speak, will bring the markets crashing down. Wall Street will absolutely crash. Now, once it crashes, you have a severe distribution problem throughout the world. Let us say it's just a complete snarl all over. Now, as we go through winter, and maybe the food stocks will last, but you have a distribution problem with petrochemicals, with the production, refining, and distribution of that. I'll tell you this, agriculture around the world is super dependent on this distribution in a very timely manner. You mess that up and you are completely messing up food production. Even more than that, with the growth of these massive agribusiness and seed companies like Monsanto, much of the seed collection and distribution businesses throughout the world have been wiped out. So there are very few local seed depositories around the world right now. Most everyone gets their seeds from these massive globalist companies. And it's very likely that they will not be able to get the seeds in a proper manner, in a proper time, from these companies. And they don't have the facilities or capability to collect the seeds from their previous harvest. And it may be such that it's too late in many places to collect seeds from last harvest. So they will be without seeds to plant. And it's going to cause a massive food shortage throughout the world. And that massive food shortage is going to lead to wars and insurrections, mass famines, mass starvations, and general absolute chaos and mayhem on this planet. And we look back at this and we say, how is it possible that all this happened? It seems like a perfect storm took place. And this will then focus us on reevaluating what the universe really is, or where that is my true purpose and being here, is I've been able to do that because I knew all this would come about in advance. From the day I was born, I knew, I saw it all, and therefore I said, you know, what's important is this reevaluation of the universe. That's what really has to take place. Because at some point, we will be compelled to do that. And those who have done that will be in a much better position, because they may be able to see then options, really great options. And the main question to be answered is, how is it possible that the universe could work in such a way? And even those who bring about their goal of population production, to quote, save the planet, they will themselves are in for a very rude awakening and surprise, because a galactic superwave and gravity wave from the center of the galaxy is also due to arrive here. And that will really finish off the planet. Whoever is left here will certainly be finished off by those events, because the gravity wave triggers massive, massive earthquakes on this planet. And that triggers incredibly large tsunamis. There will also be asteroids pushed in from the Kuiper Belt and the Oort cloud from this gigantic galactic superwave of high energy particles that the center of the galaxy emits periodically. And those asteroids, multiple asteroids, will impact the Earth, create massive amount of dust on the planet, blotting out the sun, and that will finish off most vegetation on the planet. There will be just an ongoing series of these cataclysms, and the planet really is going to be remodeled. So everybody's plans are turned to dust here. That is a fact. So how can we account for the universe behaving in such a manner? That is the great challenge that I tackled from the day I was born. I'm working on that nonstop, and have arrived at answers, definitive answers, that I'm very comfortable with. Why? What is the universe really? The universe is really a cat and mouse game between constructivity and destructivity. The cat allows the mouse to get free for its own amusement. The mouse says, ah, at last I got free of that terrible cat. And the mouse starts trundling off like, freedom, freedom, freedom. And then suddenly, pah, cat pounces. And the cat says, ah, ha, ha, got you again. And then the cat plays with the mouse a while and then lets the mouse go again. And on and on and on, you see. The universe is this perpetual cat and mouse game between constructivity and destructivity. And we can look at it, and there are those who see that, and they say, this is really crazy. And they don't say, why? Throughout the ages, that question, why? And I tell you, it's very difficult to get an answer. You have to dedicate your life to getting that answer. Otherwise, you'll come up short, because the answer is, we're not used to coming up with the answer. It's like a tradition to fail at this. And so you feel like you must be crazy to even think that you could possibly find an answer. Even the great non-dual teachers, Advaita Vedantic teachers, they say, well, we don't know why this crazy scenario is here. We only know that it is, and we know how to escape it. We don't know why it's here in the first place. But there is an exact answer as to why it is here. That is a fact, and that is the fact that I have made it a point of my life to discover this fact. Single-mindedly, I was focused on this and worked on it non-stop, relentlessly, because it's important to know that all of existence comes from one idea. It's not multiple ideas working in synchronicity together. It's one idea, and existence is simply the dynamics of that one idea playing out the way that it must play to express this idea, to give expression to this idea. But the idea itself is a really crazy idea, which is why existence seems so crazy. It's the idea of trying to replace reality with a new reality, which means getting rid of reality entirely, wiping it out and replacing it with something. You see, that is actually why existence is the way that it is. And it may take quite a bit of contemplation and clear seeing, but I have done that work. I can tell you that this is what it is. Some traditions put it slightly different way, like Course in Miracles says, we had the idea of separating from God. That's another way of putting it. It's not quite as precise as choosing the idea of trying to create a new reality. But in effect, it's pretty much the same thing, that the Spirit chose an idea of being separating from reality and creating a new reality of its own creation. It wanted to be the prime creator. And we have these allegories in religious teachings and wisdom teachings of spiritual pride is the problem that we have, that our spirit wants to be greater than God. We have the allegory of Lucifer, the great angel, archangel that turned into Satan. Because why? Lucifer wanted to be greater than God. All right. So it's in our traditions obliquely we see this referred to. But now we're looking at it just very, very directly and simply. It is simply that Spirit chose the idea of trying to replace reality with reality of its own making, so it could be God the Prime Creator instead of God the Son, the Prime Created. And so all this destructivity is the attempt to generate evidence, plausible evidence, to show that Spirit has the power to wipe out reality. So all of this existence, all these constructs, this world and plants and animals and people and civilization, etc., those symbolize reality. It's not actually reality, it symbolizes reality. It's a symbolization, a simulation, a hypothetical scenario that symbolizes reality. And then destructivity comes along and wipes it out. And then the Spirit believes, aha, you see? There is some power that can wipe out reality. At least, it gives plausibility to the notion that it's possible. And that's the cat and mouse game. And so, in fact, it doesn't really work. So what happens? More constructivity comes along. Again, all the constructs are built up. And then again, the cat pounces. Destructivity pounces and destroys it all. And again and again and again. And there are those in history who have pointed this out. Endless cycles in the universe of constructivity and destructivity goes on endlessly that way. That's how it plays. But now we know why. It's because the idea itself is the cause of all these dynamics. The idea that we chose, and something that we have not heard of yet. In spiritual teaching, this is not yet been emphasized, that you can choose a new idea. Of Course in Miracles actually began this process of emphasizing this, and this is going now a step further, very directly saying the remedy to all misery and all your suffering is simply to choose a new idea, an idea other than trying to replace reality with a new reality. That's an idea. There are infinite other ideas you could choose from. But we're not even aware of any of those other ideas. We're in complete denial, sleep, as it were, deep sleep, not even aware anymore of those other ideas. So, to loop back to the beginning here, as we go through this incredibly orchestrated synchronicity of destructive events here, and we're scratching our heads and saying, how is this possible? When many will go in just a total shock, and they've got their cabinet stocked full of pharmaceuticals, and at some point they'll probably just go in there and just gobble them all down and just go to sleep. They say, this is all too much. It just can't deal with it. Other people will just lie down and just go to sleep. It's a reaction to it all. The shock, go into complete shock, because they cannot believe this is just too much, too much, too much, too much. But those who have been pre-warned and have done the work to unravel this ahead of time, which many of you have been doing just that, because you want to survive. There's something within you that says, I'm tired of being a whipping boy of the universe, you know. I don't want any more of this. So you're paying attention and saying, I think I know pretty much what's going to happen, that this is all coming up. This grand conspiracy of the universe is once again converging on us. And so what do we do this time? Well, this time we can evaluate what the universe really is. And it's possible to finally see it and say, aha, okay, I know why this destructivity is taking place. I know very clearly what's going on. And so that takes away the shock value of it. You will feel no value in it at all, really. Because, you know, the existence is a dance of futility, really. Because you never can get rid of reality. It's impossible. Ultimately, it's futile. Ultimately, it's boring. You don't have to go into a state of shock and devastation in your spirit. You don't need that anymore. You can say, okay, Sun, do your thing. Okay, Comet Elenin, do your thing. Okay, Saboteurs, do your thing and crash the markets. And okay, Monsanto and seed companies, you've set it all up so those are going to be mass starvations. Okay, all you elite organizations that have been working for so long to orchestrate all this. Okay, you've done your thing. Okay, all those who've come into this world now who love violence, okay, they're going to have their day and they're going to do their thing. This is all going to play out, and the whole thing will collapse, and the galactic superwave will do its thing. Okay, asteroids do their thing. And then you say, same old, same old. What's the big deal? That's just the cat playing with the mouse. That's something within you will say, well, so what? Ho hum. Am I supposed to be impressed by this? Oh, I tell you, I'm not impressed by it. Just business as usual in the universe. What's to be impressed about? And then you'll look at the universe and you say, okay, so you want me to do it all over again. Let's do it all over again. And you'll say, oh, thanks, but no thanks. I think I'll take a pass on that one. And instead, I think I'm going to choose a new idea, different idea. And I'm going to experience that different idea, and it's going to be absolutely fantastic. So, ciao. Which is greater, the movie on a screen or the one viewing the movie? Don't ever let the movie on the screen tell you that somehow it's greater than you are. Don't let the universe tell you that somehow it's in control of your spirit, because it's not. It's the other way around. Spirit is in control of which idea it chooses. Once it chooses an idea, then it experiences that idea. Once you go into a movie theater, you're going to experience the movie that's showing there. It's not up to you you can't change the movie that you're viewing. However, you can walk out of that one theater and go to another theater, right? And see a different movie. You are in control. The universe does not control you the way that you think it does. You can simply say, okay, I'm tired of this one, this experience. I'm going to go choose a different idea, different experience. And we're not talking about just going to a different planet or a different dimension. We're actually, there are different ideas that are wonderful. So don't let the universe intimidate you through its displays like this of destructivity. Don't let it awe you through its displays of constructivity. It's all like a movie to you, really. Because what we are is actually, we're spirit. We're not human personalities, bodies, people, really. That's like a suit of clothes we're wearing. We're actually spirit, which is greater than the universe. The universe is just a movie we're watching. And by we, I don't mean just our perception. I mean a deeper experiencing as spirit. We're all as spirit trying to experience existence, and yet we're not content with it. We don't feel comfortable. We don't feel competent. We feel there's something wrong. It's not right. Because it's really a hypothetical instead of an actual. It's like we're having a hypothetical experience. But is a hypothetical experience really an experience? Not actually. Only plausibly. And so plausibility is always vulnerable. So we feel a sense of vulnerability that pervades everything. It's like a disease, seems like, this feeling, this vague feeling we have. It's really a feeling of vulnerability, of incompetence, of instability, of something is not right. And that will always be part of existence. We can't get rid of it. So again, cycling back to the times we live in right now, we're approaching 10-year anniversary of that most strange event, 9/11. Many, many, many people are very uncomfortable with that event because there obviously was multiple layers to what happened there. Multiple layers. The reason why nobody's really figured it out entirely is because there were a lot of synchronicities around that event of destructivity too. It wasn't just a cut and dried simple situation at all. And what 9/11 did was it caused a lot of sensitives to become nervous because we realized, this is really the beginning. This is the sign of the whale, so to speak. Those massive black buildings is a warning and a sign to the world that end times are upon us now. And events will be taking place rapidly, and we're rapidly coming to the conclusion of this world cycle, which is very true. And so as we hit this 10-year anniversary, this is the most significant time right now. It's like a cosmic trigger. And many people are nervous. They have a right to be nervous. It's a nervous time. It's a time of anxiety because we realize there is something going on in the cosmos, that we are all part of that dynamic. The cosmos is this pressure dynamic, and we're part of that pressure dynamic, and we are being influenced by that. And we are now at a time when those dynamics will begin to impact us in ways that we previously have not experienced. Except for those who have been digging into this and looking into the future, they have caught wind of this. And they say, folks, we're really in for a wild ride now. And that is true.